All right. We're recording, and I'm here with the Bradster. And Bradster, all I can say is it's another day under the sun that God has gifted, and I am glad. How are you doing today, my friend?
What could any saint say after eating Jack in the Box with a Mellow Yellow? Praise God. So, brother, we got an interesting subject ahead of us that me and you are both pretty into. I love Paul Washer and the type of writings he comes out with. What do we have to say about this, brother?
So, my friend, we have a chance today to look at a gospel tract by Paul Washer. It's called The Gospel of Jesus Christ. It is a small leaflet size book. It's maybe about the size of a Reformed Confession of Faith. So it's maybe 8 or 10 or 12 pages long, not much longer than that. And it is this succinct statement about the essence of the gospel. And it's a recent pamphlet. And so very often we talk about, in our Calvinist world, we talk about confessions of faith or three forms of unity or catechisms, creeds, that sort of thing. And in the Reformed world, so many of those documents have centuries of history behind them. And that's both good and bad. The good, of course, is that they're time-tested documents and they can be trusted and relied upon. But there's some bad in there in that sometimes the language is difficult for readers today. Sometimes the theology is difficult to bridge for new believers, new readers. And so this bite-sized tract by Paul Washer is what I love to hand out to people that I encounter and talk with when I'm witnessing, when I have a ministry to reach out to people like a street preaching. And other times when I'm out in public, somebody comes up to me, hey, I'd like to know more about what you stand for, why you're here. And this tract is just perfect. And so I thought maybe we could just talk about it and go through. There's a big movement in Christianity that goes back centuries, but in my lifetime, it was very much popularized. Christians like C.S. Lewis, who wrote this volume called Mere Christianity. Now, at its best, Mere Christianity is a distilled compilation of the essence of Christianity so that a person can engage with a small amount of theological text and still understand what the Bible's trying to say. Now, Mere Christianity movements preceded C.S. Lewis, but he really brought some meat to that movement. And his work, Mere Christianity, I think is a great work for anybody who feels that they want to know more about theology, but feels daunted by the endless volume of book after book after book. And so sometimes, Bradster, our friends will take a look at a library and they'll see a pastor's library and they'll see 1,000 books in that library. And they'll ask the pastor, have you read all of these or have you worked with the material on all of these? And typically the answer is yes. Not necessarily that the pastor has read every single word in every single volume, but that he has a professional facility with everything in his library. And there's a subset of people who will see that and be discouraged. And they'll think, oh, I'll never get to the nuts and bolts of what Christianity is about because I don't want to have to read 1,000 volumes in order to get that far. And so these movements, these Mere Christianity movements come about. And so this is Paul Washer's tract that I think gets us there. And I think it does the job as good as any tract that I work with today. Bradster, I know talking with people about the Lord is near and dear to your heart. So when you want to witness with people and you want to talk with them and you encounter something like this, what are some of the ways that you want to respond to that impulse?
So most of the time, whenever you're talking about the Lord, you find yourself on the offensive because we're talking to a culture nowadays that knows things about the Bible for the most part, but they've been taught by so many people that teach so many different things about what they quote unquote know that a superficial just, hey, I believe whatever decisional regeneration thought where you just simply say, hey, I believe. And not that they would say, hey, I made a better decision than my neighbor, but that is the quality of the theology that is being espoused from most of the people that you engage with. Oh, Jesus is good. That's pretty much the response. Oh, but, you know, I'm just bad. But he has mercy on all of us, every one of us. Well, those sort of thoughts are just the mainstream of American ideology. But really, what we focus on is how to get what we're saying to outsiders as simply as possible. Have you tested yourself against Scripture? Does the God of the Bible matter to you? Why would you even ask me that? Well, what did I do wrong? No, I'm no better than the next man, friend. But this is the thing. We know that the Bible teaches that none of us are any good, and that God restores us from that place, making us a new creation. Not because he owes it to us, but because he has chose to do this to glorify himself. And as soon as you get to a topic like that, they're like, what? I've never heard that. To glorify himself? No. You don't understand God's love. Well, this is the thing. His love is very direct, and it doesn't fail. And then you make their head spin even more. What about all these other people? Are they just going to go to hell? If it was just, everyone would go to hell. And that's what famous pastors like our man Paul Washer here that wrote this Bible tract, what he is presenting to the public, that we start off with this bad presupposition. We're all good. And equal opportunity employer is God. And he hires us if we check yes, and he lets us go if we check no. Or we just inevitably have all the say. So with that being said, I'll pass it back over to my brother.
Let me read a statement from the beginning of this tract. And so here's the idea. The idea is that you're maybe down at a street corner, somebody's walking by, they're on their way to work, or they're on their way to go and get groceries, or they have a doctor's appointment, and they're just not in a position to have an extended conversation with you. What can you say to somebody who's in that? And that's maybe not at all an obvious question for people who have studied the scriptures. The Bible is 66 books, represents, I believe, around 1 million words in the King James Version, for example, roughly 1,100 chapters. And what do you say? You just have 30 seconds to a minute with this person, and then they're going to be out of your life forever. What's the central thing that maybe is going to make a difference? And so here's Paul Washer opening with a statement that I would be very comfortable sharing with somebody and then letting them go back out into the world, knowing that in those 30 seconds, in those 45 seconds, you didn't do justice to the 1,100-ish chapters in the scriptures, but he still gave them something that's faithful, reliable, and that the Spirit can use. And so here's the text. He says, the central message of Christianity is the gospel of Jesus Christ. The word gospel means good news. Christianity offers the best news of all time. It offers the only solution to our most pressing crisis. Though human wisdom has brought many temporary benefits to us, history has also revealed how bankrupt we are to address the profound guilt and pervasive corruption under which our world groaned. The gospel reveals that God has come and won the victory for us. It is good news precisely because it is not about what we have done or can do, but what God has done and what God will do on behalf of his people. The gospel declares divine intervention into a hopeless world. Approximately 2,000 years ago, during the height of the Roman Empire, God sent his Son into human history in order to save people of every nation from their sins and misery. Christ was conceived by the Spirit of God in the womb of a virgin and was born Jesus of Nazareth, the God-man. Jesus came to bear the sins of fallen men and women and to offer his life as a sacrifice in our place. His death satisfied the demands of God's justice against sinners and made it possible for a just God to pardon them. His resurrection 3 days later testified that he is the Son of God and that God accepted his death as full payment for our sin. Now all people may be fully forgiven, reconciled to God, and receive eternal life through faith in the person and work of Jesus Christ. Through this great work of salvation, God has revealed to us who he is. Now, Bradster, that's the opening statement in this tract, and there's more to come. If I just had that 30 seconds, a minute and a half, this is pretty close to what I'd like to say, and I love it for that. Just two or three paragraphs, but so concise, so powerful. What's the kind of thing that draws you in when you hear it and how it wants to organize the material of the scriptures?
R.C. Sproul asked a question, what is the gospel? And I believe that we all should have an answer to that question. So let's talk about Jesus. Let's talk about the necessity of change. First, Jesus. Second, necessity of change. Third, spiritual death, spiritual condition. Adam, whatever you want to classify that in. It's very important that we talk about how good Jesus is and about how what he came to do was perfect and could not have failed. And the reason it could not have failed was for this reason. He is God. We have a God that cares. We have a God with a mission. We have a God that does the impossible. We have a God that came to earth, bore testimony from his mother all the way through to adulthood, baptized in the Holy Spirit, absolutely astonished the world, was the light that claimed to be, crucified on a cross for sins that he did not commit, but you committed. What you have done, all that you have done, was taken away by Jesus Christ drinking the wrath of God. The wrath of God was poured out in full against Christ. The wrath of God was poured out in full against Jesus Christ to pay for your sin debt in full, not in part, based on his finished work. He is that change that your life needs. He is that change that lasts forever. And you will be changed when he grabs a hold of you.
My friend, I love it. In the next section, Washer talks about why things should be the way they are. So when people hear about the gospel, they're immediately confronted with a situation that for many is uncomfortable. So for many people, they're walking on their way to work, or they're walking to the grocery store, or they're doing some shopping over here, or they're going to go meet Aunt Margaret, or whatever the occasion may be. And yet here you are, and you are confronting them. You are bringing something up that is not the kind of thing they would have planned on or made plans for in the day necessarily. And you are bringing what's sometimes called a gospel confrontation. Why should things be this way? And in the next section, Paul Washer talks about the reasons why the Bible lays things out in this manner. And so the first thing was that there was a knowledge of sin and the guilt that it brought. Now, this involves what Washer talks about in the character of God. And so to understand the gospel, he says, we must understand something about God. God is not an impersonal force or energy all around us, but he's the personal creator and Lord of all. A lot of people, Bradster, have an idea of the force. If you watched any Star Wars movie, you have this idea that a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away, you have these Jedi Knights, and they are plugged into this impersonal force that still acts seemingly with some sort of will. So it's an impersonal, personal force. Now, if you're not exactly sure how that can be, I'm with you. I'm not exactly sure how that can be either. But Washer says that's not reality. What is reality? Our reality, this universe, not the Star Wars universe. The reality is that the Bible teaches that the only true God exists as a Trinity, three distinct persons. Because of these qualities and the attributes of God, the way he is, his character, sin is not merely something that can be waved away. Bradster, you and I are walking down the street and you're not paying attention and you step on my toe and I go, ow, Bradster, that hurt. And you say, oh, sorry, JC Bear. And I say, well, no problem, my friend. And I think sometimes when people hear that there is something inside of them called sin, that there is a tendency or a desire to want to reach out and say, can't God just forgive? Isn't my sinfulness just like accidentally stepping on your toe or you stepping on my toe? Can't God just say, oh, no big deal. was an accident. Let's move on. We're bigger than that. You'll hear that accusation from many atheists and many agnostics, but they fail to consider the truly heinous nature of sinfulness and the truly holy nature of the character of God. Now, Bradster, I know you are wound up about the holiness of God, and I think rightly so. That's a key thing that people sometimes minimize. Would you want to talk about why the holiness of God is so vital in considering why the sin debt is such a serious issue?
As I've already laid out, I was talking about the goodness of God, and then I mentioned change and the necessity of change. For me, the necessity of change is because the standard is God's. It's not ours. And the gift is His to give, not ours to determine. And when we make ourselves the determining factor, then we're already playing God, just like Adam and Eve did with Satan in the garden. So what is the right attitude is a changed attitude. The power of belief comes forth from the power of the resurrection. The resurrection is everything. Because a resurrection was necessary, not for God to simply prove who He is to a world, that's not it. The resurrection was necessary to prove that He has power over sin, because your sin is under the same force that brought forth that curse in the garden that day. And if God was all this bad stuff everyone accuses Him of being, our species, our human race would have been wiped out instantaneously that day Adam and Eve sinned in the garden with Satan.
I think what's oftentimes forgotten, my friend, is that sin does not represent merely something being broken. We imagined earlier you stepping on my toe accidentally. And the first thought was, why can't God forgive sin like I forgave you when you accidentally stepped on my toe? And the most important thing to remember here is, first of all, that's an interesting ethical situation, but it's really not a very fair comparison. Sin is not the least bit like that accidental situation. What would be maybe a better illustration of what sin would be like would be, you and I are walking together. You step on my toe. I say, ouch. And then you pull out your knife and you stab me to death. And then you go over to my family members and stab them to death. And then you go to my house, you find my dog, you stab him to death. And then you just go and stab another 100 people or 200 people on the premise that they might just happen to know me. That's pretty extreme, J.C. Bear, somebody's going to say. Sure it is. But that starts to encapsulate the idea that sin is not merely, oh, look, I accidentally stepped on God's toe, but it's in fact the most filthy, vile, disgusting, cosmic form of treason. There's a very famous speech that an environmentalist gave in recent years, and this young lady stood up in front of her audience and talked about issues related to climate change, and then she said with a scowl, how dare you? What was the idea? In her understanding, what we had done with the climate was not merely stepping on somebody's toe, but was in fact an immoral action to be met with contempt and scorn and hatred. And so too, when we sin against God, it's not merely that we're broken and we made a boo-boo, but it's so much more that cosmic treason. And the holiness of God cannot abide that. But isn't God love? Well, sure. But the scriptures nowhere portray God as being just loving or only loving. But in fact, God is holy. And a consequence of that holiness is that not only is God loving, but He's also just. And He will do what is right when it comes to the problem of evil. Now, Bradster, I know that's a pretty heavy thing. And so the average person walking along on the way to the grocery store might not want to hear that or have that conversation. And yet, it's an important conversation to have. Where would you build thinking about that as you move past these ideas of the relationship between God and man not being in a good state?
Where I would build is really simple. Who is God and who is man? Where do we get the truth of each? The Bible is the account of truth. Now, if I said everything true is in the Bible, it's the book of truth, I would be lying, because a lot of people have told a lot of lies and have done a lot of evil in the Bible. A lot of sins have been committed by people in the Bible. But better yet, is the Bible an accurate account that is trustworthy and reliable of truth? Yes. And the accurate account tells us this, that we are no good. We are dead in sins. We are under the power of sin, as I've already pointed out from the garden. And all that are made alive in Christ are given life. Why? Christ is the life-giving Spirit. Now, what are the attributes of God? He is love. But is it love according to what you feel love is? Or is it love according to his other attributes? What he claims love is. Because his claim, if he's reliable, as I'm declaring, is this. He is love. He is holiness. He is knowledge. He is power. He is present. He is lacking nothing. He is perfection. He is justice. Everything good, right, just, and true stem from him. Every good gift comes from above, from the Father of light who never changes like shifting shadows. That God is worthy of all praise, who gives us spiritual gifts only from heavenly places. Everything that is spiritually upheld is of God, and everything that has been brought low because of man in catastrophic ways is because of what I just said, man. Sin, the sin of man. The sin of man that happened in that garden covers up the life of sin that happens in your everyday life. Whenever you think you're good, there's a million and one reasons to prove that you're bad. And there's 1,100 plus chapters to do it as well in our Holy Bible. There's 66 books as well to do it in your Holy Bible. And there's an infinite amount of wisdom to do it in the mind of God. And there is a realization known by all those who believe that I do not deserve what I have. I am given from above all good gifts, and that I cannot deny that all goodness and righteousness is held together by our sovereign Creator.
So Washer brings up what he calls the great dilemma, and that is this. He says, examine yourself. Are you a sinner? Do you recognize that you have a sinful heart and a record of breaking God's laws? If you acknowledge your sin with grief, then God's wisdom has solved your great problem in the most remarkable way. Now, if we just had 30 seconds, I know, Bradster, we've been talking longer than that, but I think if there's any one thing I find it helpful to begin with, it's to seek to establish this great dilemma. Do you realize that God is pure and holy, and you and I are evil and wicked and deserving of his wrath? Look, I admit it. You were just walking to try to go to the grocery store. You just wanted to get some fresh tomatoes, maybe a little bit of garlic, have a nice pasta sauce. And now here's somebody telling you something that's deeply unsettling if it's true. But the good news wants to come through the recognition of the great dilemma. And so sometimes people think about this problem that humankind has in a very lighthearted fashion, as if the situation was not serious. Now, I was in jail ministry for several years. I loved working with those men, talking with them, sharing the scriptures with them, listening to them, and praying with them. And I want to tell you, there's not a single person that I ministered to in that jail who didn't realize the gravity of their situation. They were going to have a court date soon, where they had to face the judge and they had to answer to the charges that were being brought against them. And I want to tell you, many of them thought they were innocent. Not a single one of them were flippant about it. And I think that would be something I would ask in the 30 to 45 seconds. Hey, good to see you. Oh, you have a religious message for me. Yes, I do. You are a sinner, evil and wicked, deserving of God's judgment. But, and then before continuing on with the but, do you recognize the great dilemma? Lots of people will say, well, no, I don't. And then we'll go down a certain path in our conversation from there. But other people will say right away, you know what? I have known for a long time that I'm not nearly as good as I like to pretend. What do you have for me? And so for people who realize that they are stuck in a great dilemma, there's an interest here. So here's the question. How can God be just, Washer asked, yet pardon those who should justly be condemned? How can God be holy, but befriend those who are evil? How can the Lord justify sinners like us and still be just? Oh, my brother, that's further than I'll get maybe in 85 to 90% of the conversation. But for those remaining 10 to 15% of the conversations, boy, I've got their attention, got their interest. People who have a respect and an understanding that they're not the good people they might like to think they are, boy, they have an interest in answering this dilemma. How would you build on that, my brother, talking with people who've come to that place in their life?
Let's make this hypothetical, okay? I'm in a room, I'm talking to a man. Have you heard of the good news? Of course I've heard of the good news. Do you even know what good news means? Yeah, it means the good news where Jesus died for everybody. Did you know that they used to announce the Roman emperors coming? Here's the good news of Claudius. Here's the good news of Nero. Did you know that means when we say good news, here's the sovereign truth of the God of the universe, that you, if you're not in right standing with him, then you're going to suffer an eternal conscious torment forever. Do you know about repentance? What's that? I changed my life. That's why you're here, huh? That's not repentance, friend. God cuts us to the heart, but he also turns us to him. He also guides us. He directs our steps. Well, that sounds weird. I've never heard of anything like that. This is Bible. It takes God to worship God. He draws us in. He teaches us to hate the sins that we commit against him and to love him because we don't deserve him and his perfection.
Paul Washer says this, if God act according to his justice, then the sinner must be condemned. If God pardon the sinner, then his justice is compromised. So that's the dilemma, but here's the answer. In justice, God condemned humanity and demanded complete satisfaction for our crimes against him. However, in love, God took humanity upon himself. He bore our sin. He suffered the penalty we deserved and died in our place. The same God whose justice demanded satisfaction for our sin made satisfaction by offering himself in our place. And so there is a special love. And the love of God is incarnated. It's made flesh in that Jesus Christ came into the world. And he came as our substitute. John 3:16 says this, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. 1 John 4 says this, God is love. In this, the love of God was manifest toward us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world, that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sin. John 15 says, greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for his friends. Upon the cross, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, offered himself as a sacrifice for his people's sin. The physical suffering and death that Christ endured were absolutely necessary. However, his suffering involved more than just receiving the cruelty of evil men. On the cross, Christ suffered the judgment of God. God's justice demanded a satisfaction for our sin, and his wrath was kindled. Christ suffered that judgment that we deserve. He bore our sin. He became a curse in our place. He was abandoned by God, and he suffered the full measure of God's wrath against us. Now, Bradster, at this point, if I'm still talking with the person, we've moved beyond the 30-second, minute and a half conversation, of course, but that's okay. The point is something wonderful has happened, and to share this is the highest privilege a person like you or I could have, to be able to go and tell someone else, hey, you know deep down that you're evil and wicked and that you are at war with God, and God will win that war, but God has made peace with everyone who will apply for his benefit. And he has done it through this giving of the Son. That's the kind of love that conquers a heart, isn't it, Bradster?
When they asked if they could sit with him in his kingdom, and he brought up the truth, can you drink this cup that I must bear? Now, we know that God's wrath was poured out against Christ, not because he loved hurting his own Son but because he hated your sin. Psalm 5:5, if you ever get discouraged and don't understand this, that'll shed a little light. He hates evildoers. He hates workers of iniquity. How much more does this shed light on those whom he favors? For mercy to be mercy, it must be given freely. If it's forced, then it's no longer mercy. The number one thing that I get whenever I talk to people is confusion. I must admit this, is these words are just words. This doesn't really matter. But those times that I speak to someone and they say, thank you, they cry, they see God, they see him as their God, is what I'm saying. It's all more than worth it. If we're asking if God is worth it, then we still haven't understood the depth of our evil and his mercy.
Romans 5 and Romans 8 have two verses that put together say this: having been justified by faith, we who believe have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. In John 14, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Acts 4 says this: nor is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. 1 Timothy chapter 2 says, for there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man, Christ Jesus. So God has acted. God has initiated. God has taken the step toward the sinner. He has set up a situation that solves the dilemma that we were talking about. Bradster, what a display of love on the part of God. He could have, what could he have done? He could have given us the divine wrath that we deserved. But in love, he initiated something far better. And he gave a gift of eternal life, a gift of adoption into his family. Bradster, I'm starting to see why this is called good news. Where would you go with that?
We have this anointing over us. Brother, you have the Holy Spirit if you're saved. But Jesus Christ is the anointed one. A lot of people don't even understand what it means to be Jesus on a basic level. Well, as the reformers have all said, he is the anointed one. He is the holy priest, king, and prophet. Priest, that he makes intercession for his people. That he is the lamb, and he is the one that provides the sacrifice. He is the one that always mediates for us. He is the one that prays for us, that pleads to the Father our case. And he is the king because he's sovereign. He's over all. He's bigger than me. He's bigger than you. He's bigger than Biden. He's bigger than Bush. He's bigger than Caesars. He's bigger than Hitler. He's bigger than anything and anyone. He is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And he was the prophet to come. He was the one mentioned in Deuteronomy 18, that whenever he comes and those who don't listen, they shall be cut off. They shall be cut off. Why? Because what he testifies is true. He said not one stone will be left on another. Jerusalem fell 40 years later. He says that he'll raise this temple up, speaking of his body. And boy, look at the Christian following that happened ever since. That resurrection from death to life, literal death to literal life, where he rose in a glorified body. He came to life by the Spirit, as ordained by the Father, and decreed long ago, and brought forth through history, and demonstrated in his people by the Spirit. His propitiation, his atonement, he satisfied the wrath of God on our accounts. His expiation, where he give good gifts to men, where he transferred his righteousness unto you, whenever he regenerates you, each in their own order, Christ, the first fruits, and all that belong to him, by giving them faith, by giving them repentance, by justifying them, guaranteeing by the down payment of the Spirit that they shall be glorified.
Now God has acted, and Washer talks about such love demanding a response from us. Washer says this: how are we to respond in order to benefit from such a great salvation? The Bible demands two things of all men. Number one, that they would repent of their sins. And number two, that they would trust in the person and work of Jesus Christ. Psalm 51 says this, "For I acknowledge my transgressions and my sin always before me. Against you, Lord, you only have I sinned and done this evil in your sight." Daniel 9 says this, "And I prayed to the Lord my God and made confession and said, O Lord, great and awesome God, who keeps his covenant and mercy with those who love him and with those who keep his commandments. We have sinned and committed iniquity. We have done wickedly and rebelled, even by departing from your precept and your judgments." Jeremiah chapter 31. "Surely after my turning, I repented, and after I was instructed, I struck myself on the thigh. I was ashamed, yes, even humiliated, because I bore the reproach of my youth." Ezekiel 20 says, "You shall remember your ways and all your doing with which you were defiled, and you shall loathe yourselves in your own sight because of all the evils that you have committed." Psalm 51 says, "The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart. These, O God, you will not despise." Brother, that might be the quote-unquote hardest part for a sinner, is to find himself or herself in agreement with this narrative, with this idea of being wicked, of being at enmity with God, and of having a desire to repent. Oh, brother, what an intense work this is. And here our so-and-so person that we're talking with thought they were just going to the grocery store to get some tomatoes for their pasta sauce. But now it turns out that eternity has pressed in upon them and presented them with this dilemma, but also with a solution. Bradster, I know it brings something to your heart, something clean and fearful at the same time. What advice would you give to someone struggling in that situation?
This is nothing like anything you've ever experienced. Everything that we experience, big risk, big reward. Everything that we experience, we collect from earning. The idea that you are nothing and you get the greatest gift in the world, and when you brag about it to people, that you can't take any credit or claim any merit with this gift is impossible to comprehend from the lens of day-to-day life, from the lens of a humanistic philosophy, from the lens of how I changed my car tire and now it's back and it's fixed. But we're not talking about just fixing something. We're talking about something being there that was never there. We're talking about change forever. We're talking about eternal change that never fails. Because for it to fail would mean God fails. For it to fail would make Jesus' mediatory work nothing. For it to fail would make the intercessory work nothing. It would make when he prays for you, when he pled your case to God, and God, he really didn't give anything to anyone. He really didn't give people to his son, right? Wrong. It's nothing like anything we've ever experienced. Because if you have a brokenness before God, that's the only thing you brought to God, all of the sins that you've ever committed.
In his Confessions, St. Augustine speaks about something that really hit home to him, that what the Bible had to say about his evil and his wickedness was true. And he described how, when he was young, Augustine and a group of friends would sneak into a neighbor's orchard at nighttime, and they would go around and they would steal fruit from the orchard. They would steal a load of pears. Now, was he bored? Did he just have nothing better to do? In his own reflection, Augustine says he did not want the pears. He wasn't motivated by any self-interest. He wasn't looking to sell the pears for money so that he and his family could eat. He simply examined himself and found he enjoyed the act of doing wrong for its own sake. And he also knows that he was with his buds, he was with his friends, and something about being in that company drove him into that theft. He would not have done it had he been by himself. And so he realizes that there's truth here. Now somebody is going to say, how can that be bad? How can that be so displeasing to God? But that's not what Augustine thought. He concluded that he was acting against God's power and goodness, and he wanted to act in a way that would not be pleasing to God. In a sense, Augustine saw himself in that orchard, acting much like his ancestor, Adam. And so there's something godly and wholesome in realizing that even the little sin, the things that don't seem to harm or hurt, still of such great offense against the righteous and good God. And yet God provides a way of reconciliation. Bradster, I think we're seeing even more and more the greatness of this gospel, the magnitude of forgiveness that's involved when you consider all the evil that's taken place throughout human history that God is going to forgive in Christ. What say you?
Vengeance is mine, I shall repay, says the Lord. And as Augustine said, don't hate the sinner, hate the sin. We shouldn't hate what we don't understand. Our battle is not against flesh and blood, but against the spiritual realm, the spiritual forces that work against us. Quite often, before we were changed, all we knew was, hey, I hate these sinners. I hate these people. I can't stand the way that person did me. And if I can, I'll get them back. It's all in us. We can shield it. We can hide. We can go to our dark corner. Scriptures teach man loves darkness more than the light because his deeds are evil. The scriptures teach clearly and clearly and clearly again and again and again. The light came into the world, but the darkness did not comprehend it. We were in a state of death, but then when God changes us, when he makes us alive from his resurrection power, granting us faith, changing us, convicting our hearts and minds, and transforming us inside out, taking out the heart of stone and putting in a heart of flesh, he does a work that no man can do, because this is like nothing, nothing we ever know. When we read his word, with man, we know everything's impossible. But with God, all things are possible.
There's really an interesting division here. And I think what this idea of Augustine and the theft of the pears gives us is Augustine said that it was foul and he loved it. He said he loved his own undoing. He says, we carried off a huge load of pears, not to eat ourselves, but to dump out to the hogs after just barely tasting some of them ourselves. Doing this pleased us all the more because it was forbidden. I was being gratuitously wanton, having no inducement to evil, but the evil itself. It was foul, and I loved it. I loved my own undoing. I loved my error. I loved the error itself. A depraved soul falling away from security in God to destruction in its own self, seeking nothing from the shameful deed but the shame itself. Friends, do you see? Is there something in your life that maybe the world thinks is very small, but you know in your heart is something like what happened with Augustine? Well, here's the good news. Augustine does not wallow in that. He does not stay in his guilt. He doesn't rest in his shame and self-loathing. Rather, something inside comes to life. And the fact of this guilt and shame drives him close to the Lord. And friends, that's the beauty. God is close. He is findable. He is willing to forgive, abundant to pardon. He loves to display mercy. Oh, Bradster, will you close us with prayer?
Dear Heavenly Father, the idea of being broken, we know, seems so ridiculous to the carnal man. We all are just carnal men without your spirit. Please breathe that spirit out on us, Lord. Give us more, because the only way we can learn more and truly have more, have any grounds to say it was from you, is if you did it and you alone. We ask you to perform many good works for our hearers, and we ask that you bless our families, that you bless our lives. May your mercy transform everything and everyone around us your way, not our way. In Jesus' name, amen.